A beautiful day, but golf in Ponce, Puerto Rico. Wow. With mountains. Welcome to the show that discusses music, both new and old. And then I try to explain it while massacring the English language and finally getting myself so confused. And I just play a musical sample so you can figure out what the hell I'm talking about. Yes, welcome to the early morning show. Cue intro. Oh, that's right. I don't have an intro. I spent all my marketing on t-shirts and mugs. Whoops. Oh, well. Bad marketing choice. Welcome, everyone. So last week, for whatever reason, some couldn't pull up my video. Even when I tried to look back later in the week and check the video, it came up as retry, tap and retry, and wouldn't work. But then a little while later, it did work. And then I had some in comments that I couldn't watch the video, while others said, it works. I don't know what went on. It beats me. And then someone goes, are you a ghost? I must have had my chair in a different location. I really looked pale. I mean, I always look really pale, but I really looked even more pale. Who knows? Those are the technical aspects of video, whatever I'm doing that I don't have a clue about. I just want to talk about some music, right? Right. Cat, he may come in. He's not feeling well. It's just snot. I mean, cat's snot. And it starts to sneeze and chunks come out. And I guess someone's got to go to the kitty doctor again. Figure out what's with all the snot. I mean, it's just like lots. Snot. Cat snot. It's gross. I mean, it's worse than human snot. We got a lot to show this week, so we're going to get going. At the end of the month, I'm actually going to head down to Savannah, Georgia for a weekend. My oldest son, Paul, is getting married this year in May. And so me, along with him and my youngest son, Eric, we're going to meet in Savannah, Georgia for a weekend just to goof around. I've never been there. They thought about a couple other places. I go, I want to go someplace where at least it's kind of warm. Always wanted to see Savannah. I hear it's the most beautiful city. So I'm going to try that, find out what's going on. And here's Snot Nose. And welcome to Cat. Yes. Meow. Yes. You're going to sit? Oh, God. That's the other part of this. Yeah. The co-host is here. You can see him on the picture. Yep. It's all about him. And he's doesn't do a whole lot except bother me. Let's sit. Yep, meow. Okay, we're going to begin with, I received some VCLT from Andre, Lindaleg. And everyone knows Andre by the Andre stick, the Lindaleg sticker. He doesn't do videos really much anymore, except on a rare occasion. But, I got to know him when I started. And a couple years ago, I had the absolute pleasure to meet him. He came up to Dallas area when I was down there for a meeting, and we went out and we had dinner and went down and did some record shopping. So just really a guy I really like. He has always sent me some wonderful stuff, and he gave me a couple albums that we'll talk about. And the first one is Blue Memphis by Memphis Slim. You can see that is white label promo. Hey, dude. We're trying to show. Yes, I know. Boy, look at that snot. Settle in. And so this is a from Memphis Slim. Memphis Slim is a piano player. And he was born in, actually, 1915, passed in 88. He's born in Memphis, Memphis Slim. And his real name is John Chatham. He really got his blues licks in Chicago, St. Louis is where he really hung out. No big, surprise there. Both huge places for the blues. He wrote the song, Every Day I Got the Blues, and he got it copyrighted. And so, you know, really for the rest of his life, he was able to have a comfortable living just off the money he earned from every day I got the blues. Would you settle in, man? Just settle down. Yeah, I'm going to toss you off. And so by 1962, he moved to Paris. He was tired. So many blues and black, you know, black blues and jazzmen, they just said, screw this, you know, America. And, you know, they found that in Europe, they liked him and there was tolerance. And so they just, he was one of them and they moved to Paris. Well, this album here, was done in 1970. And it's kind of, you could say, almost like a, well, the side one's a suite. Side one is called the Born in, it's Blue Memphis Suite. It's his life. So he sings about, he talks about his life. And it is, you know, it's just kind of, that's what the music's about, his life. And it is kind of, He talks on some, he sings, he has a huge, huge orchestra kind of behind him. Not huge, but there's quite a few people. Peter Green plays the guitar. Now, the problem with some of that backing band, and there's a lot of them, is they overwhelm him. So Memphis Slim kind of gets blown out. You know, he plays piano, but there's this funky organ happening behind him. Peter Green's playing sounds good, but can get really loud and almost overshadow him. But it's a really interesting thing, just as he talks about his life. Then side two is more kind of going into what's going on. He sings about the Vietnam War, again, 1970. He sings about the Chicago 7, again, 1970. So it all makes sense. And so it's a little more topical. With the backing of the horns and the organ and the guitars and things. Memphis Slim is a heck of a piano player. This is a really good listen to, you know, I just think at times it gets a little overwhelmed with some of the other instrumentation, but still Memphis Slim sounds great on it and really happy to have that. The other one Andre sent me is this, and this is a Miles Davis, and it is, it's really kind of, this is from Taiwan. This album came out in 1953, and Miles was 27 and just starting to lead his first band. So this is very early in his career. It's a nice example of what hard bop's about. And it's a sextet, so you can hear the hard bop. So it's this young Miles, really with this all-star group. You have on here Horace Silver, J.J. Johnson, Percy Heath, Art Blakey, all play on here as they, there it is, in Taiwanese. Really nice example of early Miles, again from 1953. This pressing came out in 1968 in Taiwan. And it was, they didn't put a lot into their, into the card stock on that, but very cool. I don't have this Miles Davis. I've never had this Miles Davis. So this was just a great fun to get because, you know, he is just like my favorite. So super happy to have this. And Andre, if you're watching, really appreciate it. And go Dawgs. If you're from Georgia, if you like the Georgia Bulldogs. And when you talk to someone in Georgia, always end it in Go Dawgs. Just, that's what you do, right? If you're from Georgia, you'll agree with me. Go Dawgs. Moving in, some new music. Pink Sigs. I heard about this album on a best, one of the best of videos from 2021 from Paul at Barocopy Dub. It's the second album I've shown from him from that video. Pink Sigs comes from Sheffield, UK. It is a heavy metal psych band. This is their second album. Their first album came out in 2020. It took them, I think, a total of 16 hours to record it. This is their second album, and it's just self-titled, Pink Sigs. The music, it is, if you took like the Stooges, mixed them with Blue Cheer, maybe toss in some MC5, you're going to get the Pink Sigs. And hey, it's pink, so that makes sense. Kind of cool. It is, it's just heavy metal, hard rock, and the host is going to leave. He just gave up on me, giving whatever he wants. It really rocks. I mean, it's catchy. It's aggressive riffs. Really wonderful sounding stuff. The vocalist, not too bad. Is he the greatest vocalist? No, he's not. But he matches what's going on with the music. Doesn't do a lot of the high wails and stuff like that sometimes you can get on heavier metal music. This is an album that makes you want to get up, to stand up, to start doing an air guitar, whatever it takes to go along with it. It is just killer. Love this album to death. If I had heard this, bought this last year, it would have been in my top 10 list. There's no doubt about it. I just thought it was such a phenomenally good album. And it's the beauty of the VC, how we hear about new groups. And Paul's the one that plays samples, and he played a sample of this. And I just go, wow, I got to have that. And, you know, you can still find them. They're still available. And I think they probably still are. Those of you that like your rock heavy, This really is it, and it does have that 70s feel, but yet it's hard rocking stuff. Really cool. Pink Sigs out of Sheffield. Paul, though, Barocopy Dub, he also showed this one. That he showed a lot of them, but I can't buy everything Paul buys. I'd like to, because the man's taste is brilliant. This is Public Service Broadcasting, is the name of the group. Public Service Broadcasting, and the album's name is Every Valley. You know, you would think, yeah, I could read it. Well, no, it's backwards when I look at the camera, so that's why I can't. Public Service Broadcasting began in 2009. That's how Pink Sigs began in 2016, so it's a newer group too. It was started as a solo project of Jay Wilgoose in London, and he released an EP, but he's expanded the group to a trio. The music, it's like, maybe some art rock, electronica, alt rock, ambient, very different. The group itself does the instrumental part of it. Then they bring in samples of from like public service films, some guy talking, so it has that 50s like vocal of a man talking. On this one, though, they do bring in guest vocalists, especially on side two, and Willie Goose sings for the very first time. This is a concept album. And, you know, it's a concept album. It's about something really I don't think we've talked enough about and that needs to be discussed probably in all circles. And that's the rise and the decline of the Welsh coal industry. In the United States, it's a big point of something we've talked about. But it was traumatic. It really was. And that's what they discuss. And, you know, Wales was, especially southern Wales, heavy, heavy coal and slate. Beautiful countryside. If you ever get a chance, it's worth seeing. It comes with this little book, and this kind of discusses the coal industry. They even sing one song in Welsh, which is like one of the most complicated languages ever. This is an interesting graph. So here we have, it starts in 1857 and ends in 2015, and it's coal production. So you could see when it started, it hit its peak in around the 1920s, and then it went to nothing. And so it discusses about this, the people. Generally, it's mostly all instrumental, but the guy from public service is this voice that comes in, talks about it over the music. And then, of course, as I said, side two, there is actual vocals that happen. But it generally is mostly about the instrumentation. It's beautiful. It is really gorgeous. If you... If some gentleman's British, a British voice talking bothers you over tracks, you may not like this. But if that doesn't bother you, and it doesn't bother me, it's actually very beautiful music. Nicely done. I don't really follow the story on it because I haven't sat to listen. I do know about, you know, the what happened with the Welsh coal industry, you know, just from reading, traveling, but... gorgeous album. Really, really nice stuff. I don't even know how to file that yet. I haven't figured that out. What do I file it under? Because it's just a different kind of genre. It really is. Got this at Christmas from my wife. She went to my Amazon list. This is the second album. She gave me two Horace Silver albums that I had on there. Six Pieces of Silver came out in 1956. For those fans of hard bop, this is like one of those grails to find one of these in original, because Horace Silver was an originator of hard bop. His piano playing is beautiful, and he was such an important part of it. The cast on this album, it's like the Jazz Messengers from the year before. Donald Byrd is on trumpet, Hank Mobley's on sax, Horace Silver, of course, plays piano, Doug Watkins on bass, Lewis Hayes on drums. It's really a fantastic group, and a lot of them played in the Jazz Messengers in 1955. On here, Horace Silver, he does five of the six tracks are his own. He wrote and composed. Only For Heaven's Sakes was done by someone else. A couple of these on here, Cool Eyes and Senior Blues, have both become jazz standards. I've become a really big fan of Horace Silver. You know, I fell into him about 3-4 years ago because I was out record shopping with one of the VC members that no longer does, Chris at First Pressing Goodness. And he put a Horace Silver in my hand, says, you need to get this. And it was Songs of Our Father. And I became a huge fan because of Chris. So wonderful stuff. Great music. Then, let's go another African album, King Sunny Ade. God, I don't need to even take this thing out. Oh, yeah, Chihuahua. Okay, King Sunny Ade. Even has the original inner sleeve. There's the label. All right, so we have Sunny Ade and his Green Spot Band Volume 5. No one really knows when this came out. Kind of a guess is maybe around 85. Sonny Adey, born in 1946, still alive. He was doing 2 to 6 albums a year. He has hundreds of albums that he has done. He hasn't done an album since 2004, though, but his discography is enormous, how much he put out. And so here we just have more of his stuff, more of his recordings from African Sounds Unlimited. This was recorded in Nigeria, which is, of course, where a lot of people did the recordings. It's Juju music, which we discussed before. Juju, there's a lot of vocal to it. There's a lot of vocal, and it's blended with percussion and guitars and keys, and actually choreographed dance is a big part of it. Juju takes traditional African sounds and makes them modern. And Sonny Adey, later King Sonny Adey, was the king at doing that. And it really is the Juju master. A lot of call and response on the singing along with talking drums. This album itself has a lot of Africa in it. And when I say a lot of Africa, I mean the vinyl. The vinyl, half of Africa, half the dirt in Africa is on the vinyl. And I've had it deep cleaned. I've brought it in to have electronically cleaned. And it just can't come out. The album itself, I think, was attacked by a lion. It survived an animal attack. So this album's been through hell. It's still feeling hell. It's never going to kind of recoup. But the thing is, it's an original. So, you know, for us lovers of African music, you can just get an original and you just go, ooh. I can't say my needle on my turntables for too excited about the freaking thing. No, it's all going. Don't you play me. But Sonny Adey is such an important artist. That's one of those, if you see one and you go, I don't know anything about African music, Sonny Adey is very pleasant, very good to listen to. And he has hundreds of albums. You gotta run across him sometime. This is from Record Store Day, from Madlib and Mamo. Madlib, his real name's Otis Jackson Jr. He's an experimental hip-hop artist. I love what Madlib does, especially when he takes jazz and reworks it and gives it a hip-hop feel. Mamo, Ivan Mamokorti, I believe, I'm sure I'm saying it wrong. He has a group, and they do pop samba out of Brazil. So, this album, the two get together. This came out in 2002 first, and it's called Sujinho. It's Brazil. It's Portuguese, so screw it. It takes Brazilian music, more traditional Brazilian, and they update it. Madlib comes in, gives it that electronic hip-hop type feel, so you have these beats going on, but yet the music still retains that Brazilian feel to it. It is wonderful stuff. I forget how many it was limited to, but I am so... This was one of the picks that I had to have. I didn't know anything about it. I just saw Brazilian music, Madlib. What more could I ask for? And I got what I wanted. Something really, really great. It's just full of cool grooves. Very laid back vibe. Very cool. Very interesting music. Just well done. Just another great album from Madlib. I never go wrong with Madlib. Mozart. I love classical music, and I have a lot of classical music. I still buy classical music. It's not shown much. There are classical music channels. I don't really subscribe to them. There's a couple I watch when I see a video come up. But classical music has cool songs, cool stories. This one, and it is the Serenade 320, Serenade 239. Okay, if that helps you. The Posthorn Serenade. I thought they called it it's actually Serenade number 9, Serenade number 6. Number 9 and number 6 from Mozart. Mozart, born in 56, died in like 1791. That's 1756, at age of 35. He did this when he was 23 years old. Over half his life was done, and he is already well into music. He began touring when he was age 5. His father was a composer and a teacher. His older sister, Nanelle, was also a child prodigy, so him and his sister would go around Europe touring and playing for the kings and queens. You didn't have radio, you didn't have anything. You wanted music, you brought in musicians. They were your music. That's how you got entertained. So by age 8, he had written his first symphony. By this time, he was well on his way. I think he might have still been in Salzburg, which he wasn't happy, and he wrote these serenades. So a serenade is something that is written, and it's music, it's to honor someone. It's for a special occasion. So it's not dark music. I mean, this is, it's joyous music because we're celebrating you. We're going to talk about you. And so serenades, if you see something, you know you're going to get something that's going to be lighter. It's not heavy orchestra because it's, you know, usually going to be a smaller ensemble playing it, but it's going to put a smile on your face. And that's what that does. They're lighter pieces of music, but yet there's a lot of joy to them. So serenades are great to hear. And so Mozart did this. I mean, Mozart, you know, man, as he recently did a thing on wankers. I mean, Mozart is a wanker. He's a dick. He's awful. He drove his family to bankruptcy. I mean, because it was about him, not about them. I mean, just, he's a dick. But the music is immortal. It is. You know, we even think of our rock and roll. We're talking 17, when was this one? This was made in 1779. And still gorgeous to this day. So, yeah, if you see it, just Mozart serenades, I'm telling you, it's just, it makes you feel good. Great music to play. It's uplifting. There you have it. Thank you once again for, you know, hey, sticking with me. I appreciate that very, very much. We'll work on that early morning show. You know, I used to have an intro. Everything I do is really homemade. It was my Mr. Rogers song in my old music room. But, you know, it went on for a minute. And eventually, I think everyone wanted to put a gun to their head. But it was fitting. You know, if I had my Mr. Rogers sweater. Have a midweek coming up. Bring in, I got a lot of great albums that I brought back into the collection. And I hope you joined me for this. And last week I did my favorites of 71 and sang a song from 72 because, as usual, I screwed up. Thanks. That's what I'm all about. Have a great week. Bye.